Hi, in this video we are going to cover Software Mining's Cobol analytics tool and its use in migration of Cobol applications. The tool's primary focus is application flowcharting, cold chain analysis, and documentation, with a view to help in migration projects. In that context, it helps to identify the series of related and interdependent programs which need to be translated and migrated together. For example, if program A calls B, calls C, and D, then all of these need to be translated together and not just program A in isolation. On startup, the tool first goes into its documentation and information page. This covers video tutorials for the translator, translators troubleshooting, and a series of documentations and how-tos, from runtime libraries and IDEs to deployment, treatment of JCL files, as well as EBCDIC migration. Next is the projects tab. Before we do anything, we need to set up the project repository, which is a folder containing all the COBOL files, copybooks, BMS definitions, and even the JCL files. As this is a Microsoft Windows tool, all the set files need to be put in a drive accessible to the machine it's running on, meaning all the files need to be FTP'd and copied from the mainframe. Setting up the project repository is covered in a separate video. Please see tutorial number 2. One thing I have to recommend here, though, is to use different file extensions to represent different file types. For example, .cbl for COBOL files, .cpy for copybooks, .bms for BMS, .jcl for JCL, and so on and so forth. For this demo, the repository I'm using here contains a simple set of COBOL programs and JCL files, which are distributed with this application. Now let's look at the cold chain tab, which is the main focal point of this application. On the left-hand side, we have various categorizations of all the files in this repository. For instance, we have the entry points here, which are programs which call others, but they themselves are not called by anyone else. Then we have a list of all the programs here, and clicking on any of them, it will draw the flow chart for that one. You can also ask the system to expand it, and it shows you all the other interactions with other programs, lists them, called from, calls, copy files, SQL tables, so on and so forth. We have a list of copybooks. These are the copybooks the system has found. We have missing copybooks, and in this case it shows you which program was calling it, so you can go and fix the program. No connectivity programs, which basically no one calls, and it calls no one either. And basically we can got to consider, is it dead? Why is no one calling it? Why it doesn't call anyone else? Then we have libraries, which are effectively any program which has more than 7 other programs calling it. You can change that value of 7 to anything else and rescan the directory. Then beyond that, we have the missing programs. For instance, assembler 2 is used in program X, is missing, so you can go and find it again and put it in the repository. Online programs, which are effectively any programs with kicks send and receive, or COBOL accept and display. And then we have batch programs, which don't have on accept display. And then we have BMS programs, BMS map sets that the system has found, and it shows you where it's used. Moving on, we can go down here, and here are the file division material that it has found. For instance, it has found print file is referenced in 2 different programs, and also SQL tables. It has found detail table, which is referenced in 1 program. Now let's see how the information presented in the flowchart area can help us to better understand or document the application. In this view, programs are represented by boxes and calls are represented by lines connecting the boxes, with the arrows showing the direction of the call. You can ask the system to show call types. This differentiates between the calls which were made by standard COBOL statements and those which were made by kicks, links, and XCTL statements. Now, typical applications, usually much larger than this demo, with many, many more programs, boxes, and connections. So how can the tool help to show the information relevant to execution of a program? Before we go there, let me give you a little tip. You can move these boxes, and you can also simplify the connection between the boxes. By, for instance, to remove a connection joint, click on the mouse and hold it for half a second, and that connection is gone. And that allows you to sort of to move the boxes around and get a better clear view of who connects to it. But let's go back to showing the information relevant to execution of a program. Okay, let's select a program and see how it relates to other programs. One way to do this is to click on highlight links. In this case, it's showing that program C is linked to B and D and logDT. It also shows that it's linked to report file. So basically, when you click on this highlight button, for 2 seconds, it'll highlight anything which is directly linked to it. Another way is to click on navigate. In this case, again, it's showing anything downstream. C calls D, which is calling logDT. And if you wanted to show upstreams, you can click on this button, show associated programs. So in this case, it shows A calls B calls C and the other ones which are also in the chain. So for instance here, let's see, where did E come from? Highlight link again, and okay, it was called directly from A. For 2 seconds, it'll show what's going on. Also note that when you navigate to a program, it also shows it on the left-hand side in the tree view. And in there you have all the additional information, who called it, where was it called from, and additional files. As I mentioned in the beginning of the video, the purpose of the tool is to help preparing programs for code migration or translation to new languages such as Java and C Sharp. When you select a program, as well as showing the flowchart on the right-hand side, it also lists all the associated programs in the middle pane. The point of the middle pane is to, again, to help in the translation process. So let's select a couple of the programs from the middle pane and click on prepare. That takes you to the next screen, the prepare the translation screen. Before we click on translate, bear in mind that you need to go to file and setup and set up your target directories and target language. Is it C, is it C sharp, so on and so forth. And once all that is done, you can come back here and click on translate. Now bear in mind, these are small programs and the repository rather small, so it takes, it goes pretty quickly. Now if you go back to cold chain tab and click on rescan, what you can see is, let's go back to JCL, you can see the two programs that we had selected are turned green, which means basically if there are associations, you know, for instance, let's say select program M, that also calls logDT. So you know which one's been translated, which one hasn't been translated, and you can go in there and select all the other ones in this chain and prepare them and translate them again. Please note, this example uses just a few small programs. If the programs are large or if there are a lot of programs, the process will take much longer depending on the configuration. The more the system tries to clean up the generated code, for example, by removing go-to statements, including code reuse, or identifying dead segments of a program, the longer it will take. Once the process is finished, you can click on the output directory up here to see the resulting code. See our other documentation on how to use the code in development tools such as Eclipse or Visual Studio. Also, by clicking on the refresh button here, you can see all the programs and you can bypass the cold chain analysis process and make your own selection of what needed to be translated. For example, right-hand click in this window and the system will give you a few helpful options. Okay, that's the end of this tutorial. I hope you found it useful. Send us an email if you have any questions.